Hi, let's talk about facial nerve palsy, also known as Bell's palsy. In this video, we'll discuss facial nerve palsy and how one may distinguish between facial nerve palsy and a cerebrovascular accident, a CVA, or a stroke. But first, we should tip our hats to the person who first described facial nerve palsy. That would be Sir Charles Bell. So Sir Charles Bell was a Scottish anatomist, neurologist, and surgeon who, among being the first individual to describe a facial nerve palsy, was also the first person to describe the differences between motor and sensory nerves in the spinal cord. So, the honorific of Bell's palsy, which we use interchangeably with facial nerve paralysis, comes from Sir Charles Bell. So what is a facial nerve palsy? Well, these palsies or these parises are the result of damage to the facial nerve, and as a consequence of that, the ipsilateral or same-sided facial muscles are either paralyzed or they're weakened. There are a couple of other symptoms that may accompany a facial nerve palsy. So ipsilateral hyperlacrimation, so a diminished capacity for tears on the affected side, and that's because the facial nerve, if it's damaged high, say either at the brainstem or in the facial canal, then that could affect the greater petrosal nerve. That's the nerve which carries the preganglionic parasympathetic fibers to the trigopalatine ganglion, which serves the lacrimal gland. There can also be ipsilateral hyposalivation, and that's because the chorded tympani, which also arises in that facial canal, carries preganglionic parasympathetics to the submandibular ganglion, which is servicing both the sublingual and submandibular glands. There's also the potential for ipsilateral adusia, which is a lack of taste from the anterior tongue, again, because of our good friend chorded tympani. And there's the possibility for, but clinically, it's exceedingly rare, for hyperacusis, and that is for sound to seem too loud for a person. And that's because coming off of the facial nerve and the facial canal, the nerve to the stapedius, which is a muscle in the middle ear that helps to dampen sound. But again, that's pretty rare. The dead giveaway for Bell's palsy is the ipsilateral paralysis or paresis. So if we're looking at this individual, you can see the complete absence of furrow lines on the brow. The upper eyelid is drooping, so there's a little bit of ptosis there. Sometimes even the lower eyelid is drooping. The angle of the mouth, you can see, takes a diminished downward turn, and many of those lines that we would see on the face, they don't appear with the same vigor, except maybe to accentuate the sagging of skin on the side that is affected. So this is all due to an injury or a compression on the facial nerve, and it can be anywhere along the facial nerve. There are many different possible causes, herpes simplex viruses, Epstein-Barr viruses, edema or swelling can compress the nerve. So either as the result of injury or exposure to cold, this is a known sometimes sequelae to pregnancy, but most of the times a facial nerve palsy is idiopathic. We just don't simply understand the underlying cause for it. And again, this typically presents as ipsilateral to the side of the injury, but there are instances of bilateral Bell's palsies. Usually these accompany like Guillain-Barré syndrome or Lyme disease or something that that may affect the nuclei of the facial nerves in the brainstem. So in differentiating Bell's or facial nerve palsy from a cerebrovascular accident or stroke, which is another potential cause for facial nerve paralysis, it's good to understand where the lesion, whether it's a lesion to the facial nerve or a lesion to an upper motor neuron in the brain, could occur, and what impacts that might have on an individual. So let's just start over here towards the distal end of the nerve and kind of work our way back. So the facial nerve, just to review, has two major divisions. There's the temporofacial, and the cervicofacial. And the temporofacial division gives rise to these temporal branches and some to the zygomatic branches. And so this division predominantly is going to serve the frontal belly of occipitofrontalis and it will be complementary to orbicularis oculi as well. So that's an important fact to understand as we walk our way through this. So upper motor neurons, you know, controlling the facial muscles are coming from the cerebral cortex, and they're going to descend down through to the pons, and in the process of this descent, they decussate or they cross over. So here, let's follow the yellow here as it comes down, and some of the yellow stays on the same side, but most of the yellow is crossing over to the opposite side. Now, as we follow the yellow, so here it is exiting. There's the facial nerve from the brainstem going out, right? Now it's in the facial canal, makes kind of a Z shape through that canal, and then it's again exiting from the skull through that stylomastoid foramen. And as you can see, the bulk of that yellow is servicing the cervicofacial division exclusively down there, whereas the temporofacial division is a mix of fibers coming from the right side as well as fibers coming from the left side. And so what we see here is that those temporofacial fibers, they're being sourced bilaterally in the brain. And the cervicofacial fibers are sourced unilaterally. So if there is, let's erase some of this. Let's imagine that there is a cerebrovascular accident that affects these upper motor neurons high in the cortex. CVA affects that. As a result, an individual is going to lose their contralateral tone of the cervicofacial muscles, whereas the temporofacial muscles, frontal belly, in part orbicularis oculi, should still have some function to them. So a person with a cerebrovascular accident is more likely, well, I should say a cerebrovascular accident affecting the facial nerve, is more likely to have contralateral lower face paralysis. Whereas with facial nerve, erase all of this, whereas with facial nerve, if the lesion is, say, in the facial canal, even before it comes out of the stylomastoid foramen, you're knocking out all of the facial nerve functions to the face. And therefore, the entirety of the ipsilateral, same-sided face, will be paralyzed or weakened. So that should lead us to our assessment question. You know, in this scenario, you are the dentist, and after administering an inferior alveolar block, you are briefly pulled away for a consult. You return to your patient, and they were accompanied chair-side the whole time by your assistant. And you notice that there's a unilateral loss of facial muscle tone. Uh-oh. You calmly instruct the patient to smile. Maybe you don't tell them to smile. Maybe you say something charming or funny. And you notice that there is absolutely no furrowing of their forehead. Is this an encouraging, i.e. a good sign? A, no. Call 911. It's an emergency. Potential stroke on the differential. B, yes. So the keys to this question, let's see, what were you doing? Well, you were administering an anesthetic to the IAN. So, you know, who knows what that could have done? And then you see unilateral loss of facial muscle tone. That's problematic. And when they're instructed to smile, to really use those facial muscles, or when you coax them into it, you see no furrowing of their forehead. Therefore, there's complete unilateral paralysis. Complete unilateral paralysis is suggesting that the entirety of the facial nerve has been somehow compromised or diminished. And as a result of that, it's most likely that what you're witnessing is the nascent formation of bells. And probably what has happened in this situation is that you missed your target for your IAN. And this would be a huge whoops. You probably went way too far posteriorly on the ramus of the mandible, and you could have hit a deep part of the parotid gland, or perhaps infiltrated into the capsule of the parotid gland, and that anesthetic then bathed the branches of the facial nerve as they traversed the gland. Your patient probably isn't going to be very happy as a result, but it is very likely not an emergency. Thank you very much for your time.